Are your finances kind of a mess? Did you start a new online business like Patreon or OnlyFans and you're not sure how to deal with the income? Need someone to decode and translate your tax return? Or are you confused about how to handle the influx of money from a Kickstarter, GoFundMe, or even renting out a spare room on Airbnb? What you need is M3 Virtual Accounting. Molly Morris is the accountant for Unspoiled and other successful podcasts, and she can advise you on how to launch a new business, manage the books on an existing one, and meet with you virtually to discuss specific concerns and questions. All of your information is kept in a secure portal where you can upload new documents, sign remotely, and download copies for yourself. Molly has been great to work with, and I wish I had hired her sooner. Her rates are flexible, and she's willing to work within your budget. Her goal is to make professional accounting accessible to small businesses and startups, and she would love to talk to you about what you need. Check out her website at m3virtualaccounting.com and book a free consultation by choosing Book Online in the menu. If you're like me, you will wonder how you ever lived without her.
This is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 14, Cold Days, Chapters 34, 35, and 36. In these chapters, Harry has a conversation with Rashid about what the fuck is going on with these gates, and gets dropped off back in his grave, and then he has a conversation, I hate to use that word because it's not really it, with Molly. That's incredibly uncomfortable. Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder, power and rain. I'm coming on like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. Welcome to the show, everyone. I am Natasha.
I'm Rashawn.
All right, Rashawn, lay it on me. Your impressions from these chapters. What stuck? What did you like? What did you hate? Tell us everything.
The most important thing that happened was, of course, the reunion with Mouse. That is, I don't care what anyone has to say, that is the most important thing that happened. That was the most important bit of information that we got. It was really what we are all here for, and
I think that's fair.
It's honestly about time. Chapter, you know what I mean, it's chapter like 36 when that happens. What was the holdup? The other stuff, you know, like the big points, I feel like we're all gonna be in agreement. The revelation that the gates are as Harry says, the supposed to be a metaphor, but they are not. They are real.
Yep.
Rashid being both wildly helpful and also useless at the same time.
Oh my god.
Which is a trick I thought only fairies could pull off, but apparently, you know, that is, maybe that's a skill he picked up from so much, you know, time spent working with the Fae. Who knows?
I fucking love him just being like, oh, you're going to have a lot of bureaucracy ahead. I can help you with that. As for the other stuff, you get used to it. And Harry's like, what?
Harry poo-pooing that help with the bureaucratic shit, though, is super short-sighted.
It really
is. I mean, one of our dearest and most beloved friends could use that help right now. Mm-hmm. As you know, she tries to prove to the world that she does, in fact, exist.
She is not actually dead.
So, I thought Harry was being a little flippant there.
I think that it is that, you know, I don't know that the world is still going to exist tomorrow, so you actually don't, like, your offer of help could be meaningless. And to a degree, I get that, but also, like, operate as if it's going to be there tomorrow. Just go ahead with that. It's fine.
Some of us live our entire lives like that. Mm-hmm. And by some of us, I mean me. I am not always very certain about tomorrow. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm never certain about tomorrow and whether I have any interest in being here for the next day. Mm-hmm. But you still have to do the things to make the potential tomorrow, you know, make sense.
I also wonder because, you know, Harry had been concerned about what they would do in reaction to finding out about his role as the Winter Knight now. Mm-hmm, and that isn't really mentioned by Rashid. Like,
I thought he did talk about that.
Did he? You know what? We'll get to this. Okay, let's start off with the beginning of their conversation. First of all, Rashid says something about how Harry takes after his mother because he is way far out from home. And Harry is surprised that he knew his mother. And Rashid basically is like, she was somebody who was super familiar with the ways. And those of us who got good at that got to know each other really well. And I thought that was interesting. Like, that is a sort of specialized hobby.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And it just sort of feels like being in any subculture. I always think of, whenever I think of like this sort of specialization, I think about murder TV shows, especially like Midsummer Murders. Those of you who are fans of that show, there's always, every episode they choose a different like subculture that is having some sort of weird inner turmoil that somebody got murdered over, and the investigators have to start to learn what is important to these weirdos with this hyper-focused interest. So it could be something like building model ships or home brewing beer or anything. And, you know, somebody turns up drowned in a keg of beer, and then you find out that there's all these like petty jealousies because he used the same wood that I did for his aging, and that was just beyond the pale. And I just sort of have a curiosity about people who walk the ways, because he says we would have dinner every so often, compare notes of our walks. And there were several of us who were friends of Ebenezer who took it upon ourselves to watch over her. And I just find this very compelling. I want to know more about all of that.
Yeah. I like this quick mention, too, of it being a way to signify that, yes, Rashid knew who she was.
Right. Yeah, that too.
But in the conversation between him and Harry in this moment, there's no, like, mention of that. There's no need to confirm it one way or the other. It's just a very kind of, like, you know that I know that you know that I know kind of moment, you know. But I like those little moments. Also, the thing, too, about this relationship that Rashid had with, I guess Maggie, we'll call it, it's weird calling her Maggie now. I know he's got a daughter called Maggie, but
call her Margaret Le Fay.
Margaret, that we don't often, or I don't anyway, I don't often think of her as a whole person because we don't know that much about her, you know? Mm-hmm. She's still such a mystery to me, 14 books in. And whenever a little bit of information comes out about her, I'm always just like, why aren't we talking about her more?
Mm-hmm.
You know? So I'm very interested in what her life was. And I like the tie-in because when, what does Harry get? He has the amulet that helps him.
Right. You know, it's a stone that he like put into his pentacle. It's like a little ruby, I think it is.
Right.
And he glued it in there.
So, and that helps, you know, him, you know, make his way through the ways.
Get it.
And I start to wonder, like, well, you know, does Rashid, like, how did he get the who gave that to him?
Who gave what?
Who gave Harry the stone, the ruby?
Oh, Mab. Because he says, is there anything that my mother left for me that that you were to hold on to until I was old enough to ask for it? And she smiles and is like, ah, oh, you finally have asked for the thing. And she gives it to him. This is during changes. And that's how they're able to get to Chichen Itza at such short notice.
Right. So I start to wonder, you know, did Rashid help her make that? Like, does he have one? You know? Like, mm-hmm. So I don't know. I just have a lot of questions about her, and I'm dying to know more about her. So whenever these little moments pop up, I'm just like, ah.
Same. Yeah, his mother just endlessly fascinates me. I hope that we find out more about her. And, you know, she sounded highly questionable in terms of ethics in certain places, but so Harry would sound that way too to someone on the outside. Like,
exactly. Like, out of context, she sounds like hella flaky, quite frankly. Mm-hmm. And, you know, like, she's just out here. But then we don't know what was driving her decision-making, you know. And I think what you just raised is an excellent point. From the outside, I mean, even it doesn't even have to be, like, from the outside. Like, low-key Rashid is like, you've been, like, bumping around the edges of all this shit for years, Harry. Like, what mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, because Harry asks at one point, like, how long has this been going on? And Rashid is literally like, what? And he's like, the battle at the gate. What do you mean, what? And he's like, this? This is forever. Like, yeah. This is just how it is. You yeah. have to know that, right? I just really enjoy everybody being like, Harry, fucking catch up, buddy.
That's really funny too throughout the chapters is everyone is kind of like, oh, you finally get it, and then a second they're like, ah, shit. You know, like, all right, well you're closer to getting it than you were, so that's something, and we'll
exactly
so yeah, they're having this conversation in the middle of this battle that rages endlessly, and it's like a little bit of a lull, and Rashid is like, I know you have questions, I don't have a lot of time, like, let's get into it. And he takes his hood off, which doesn't happen often, and we are reminded that, you know, one of his eyes is gone. Mm-hmm. And in this realm, the eye is its, I guess, like, its real self. It doesn't have to be disguised.
Yeah.
And it is made out of the same material as the outer gates, mm-hmm. which, I mean, it's a real close tie between who has the better eye, Mad-Eye or Rashid, and, you know.
I didn't even think of Mad-Eye. I don't know what is wrong with me that it didn't occur to me to make that comparison, but holy shit, I'm slipping.
But it's neck and neck, though, right? Mm. Because Rashid's eye helps him, how Harry ends up understanding it is that the gates work is like a scanner, mm-hmm. and Rashid's eye works in the same way, and it helps to make sure that things aren't slipping in that shouldn't be slipping in.
Somebody mowing a lawn.
Yeah, there's like a leaf blower action these happening sons outside. Of bitches. Yeah,
and it's just rude on a Saturday morning, like, you know, come on, everybody.
And the thing is, there's not even that much grass anywhere near me, you guys. Like, I don't understand what's happening. You know, there's like a patch of grass in front of the restaurant, like next door to me. What are we doing? It's probably a fucking leaf blower. That's probably what that shit is.
I find that so like, it like, look, I get it. I don't like to rake, but the fact that we have leaf blowers is just so pathetic.
It really is. I don't know much about heavy equipment, but I assume they run like on gasoline. Mm-hmm.
Which I'm pretty sure, yeah.
Right? That's not good. Just burning all that gasoline to like blow leaves around.
That literally the wind can undo 10 minutes later. Like, are we doing this? Okay.
I don't know what to tell you guys. Saturday in the big city. Outside the big city. Outside the kind of big city.
Yeah, really, you sound like you're in the suburbs. Because that's the sounds that I assume, like, I associate with being here.
Yeah. I'm definitely in the suburbs.
Yeah, I guess, compared to where we are, it's not. Yeah, but compared to the rest of Philly, it is.
Yeah. And compared to the rest of the suburbs, though, I practically live in the city. Like, I don't live, like, out far enough where people are, like, having nice big houses and nice big lawns, you know. That's a couple miles down the road from me. So
yeah, this is, he, like you said, the false eye, can see whether or not Nemesis is hiding inside the wounded so that they don't wind up inviting the enemy right through their gates.
Mm-hmm,
and that's also part of what the gate does. He's like, it does other stuff. That's one of its functions. It does a lot of things.
Yeah.
And he says also that spotting Nemesis is an art, not a skill, which is interesting. So it's not like the eye just like shows him Nemesis hiding in there. It's a combination of factors. And he even says that you can use the sight.
He doesn't recommend that shit at all.
Yeah. Harry sees this like twitch in him and recognizes the like mental stutter from the trauma of looking at something with your sight that's truly fucking horrifying. And is like, all right, I guess I won't be doing that.
There's this moment when they first start talking and Rashid is just like, oh, okay, so you're up to speed. I thought that you were going to die way before you got a chance to catch up. And the first thing Harry really says to him after hearing about, like, the gates and all that is that he says, how can I help? And Rashid is so impressed by this and says, you know, basically, you got a lot on your plate, not to mention all the other shit that you've created problems for yourself that you don't even know about yet. And yet here you are offering to help. I think you and I could be friends. Which is a really nice, like, non-sappy way
exactly
to really express like appreciation for someone's willingness to help despite all the things that are burdening them. Mm-hmm. And it is a real like moment of insight into Harry's character. That like at his core, that is always going to be the thing that Harry Dresden says is, how can I help? And I really like that.
That's true. That's true.
I really like that. Yeah. And then Harry's like, I have problems. I haven't been trying to cause any problems. I'm like, dude, have you been reading these books?
What oh my God. Dude. It's just like, there's always so many moving parts. The fact that he thinks that he would be able to tell.
Yeah.
I mean, come on, guy.
Yeah. I feel like up until now, it's changing, you know, as Harry's starting to get glimpses into the clearly much bigger picture that has been happening this whole time. But up until this point, it really does feel like Harry does what I do as a reader, which is once the book is over, I'm like, oh, okay, that problem's solved. You know, let's open a new book and see what new problems there are. You know, because you feel like, oh, that chapter's done. Like literally, you're closing the book on that problem. Meanwhile, all those books are on your bookcase, conspiring against you, talking to each other when you're not listening.
It's just, they're so, like, Harry, if you could read these books, you'd realize there are so many characters going on with their lives off page that suddenly decide to pop up and just be like, remember me, stupid? Right, and you're I didn't, actually. My bad. That I can't imagine you think you have a handle on everything that's going on, you know?
This is like a web that is, you know, massive. And it would be, I think, impossible to see everything at once. You know, it's just, it's so expansive that, like, you're looking at one little corner and you don't realize that, you know, the little porch you're looking at has, like, 18 stories built on top of it because you're just looking at the front of the building.
Yep.
But, so Harry needs to know a couple of things, and or she doesn't have a lot of time. So Harry wants to know, you know, about how to tell if someone has been infected, and that's when Rashid starts talking about the site.
Mm-hmm.
And they talk about how the outsiders are always, always, always trying to get in. Mm-hmm. And that over time, different, I don't know what to call them, but over time, different things are responsible for keeping the gates. And right now, it's winter. Mm-hmm. Like she says, in our age, it is the task of winter to defend the boundaries. I don't know who it was before, and apparently, you know, it could be someone after if we don't all die in this book.
Right, yes. That is key, is the not dying part.
And Harry wants to know, all right, well, if it's winter, and winter is our immune system, what happens if, you know, it breaks down? And here, Harry, I think, it's clear he's talking about what happens if there's a change in, like, leadership, like Maeve takes over. And Rashid just says it could be problematic. Rather severely so.
I don't know why that killed me so bad when he says that. It's just such a complete understatement. I'm like, guys. Yeah.
Then they start talking about, Rashid starts telling Harry that, like, you just, you know, you get, wait, before he says it, it's very important. He sets it up as, like he puts his staff down and, like, takes Harry by the arms. Listen to me. This is important. You get used to it. Harry is not impressed with this.
Harry's like, that's the pep talk? And he's like, pep. Pep. No. You don't need pep. This is not pep. He's like so offended by the use of that word. Really?
He tells Harry that what is needed is Harry. What we need is you. Mm-hmm. And basically, it's like everything has been leading up to this moment. You know, everything you've done, you've been kind of sticking it to the adversary without even realizing that you've been doing it. Mm-hmm. And Rashid tells him, how you can help me is go back to Chicago and keep doing what you have been doing.
Keep being yourself.
Which, you know what? Isn't that a nice thing to say to someone? That's a really, really, I know this is not the context of it in the story, but just as an aside, to tell someone that what they can do to help you is for them to just keep being who they are, mm-hmm. is so generous and really, really gracious, and quite frankly, a beautiful sentiment. Like, it is, I don't know, like, think about it. Like, how often does someone say that to you? You know?
Yeah.
Like, you know what you can do for me? Just keep being exactly who you are. Keep doing exactly what you do. That is, like, such validation. It's a bit breathtaking, but also I'm going through some shit, y'all. I might be a lot into this, but yeah, I don't know. It moved me. It really did. In a conversation, it's a little like funny because it's, you know, the problems that are being faced are so overwhelming. Mm-hmm. And then the pep talk is you get used to it. And then the answer to how you can help is just keep being you. You know, there's a lot of humor in that because the moment is so big and what Rashid is saying feels so inadequate. Mm-hmm. But it really is what is needed. And he really does tell him what he needs to know. So I don't know. I really enjoyed this.
Agreed.
And then he starts this. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
I'm saying then he starts talking about, like, you know, after if we don't die, I'll help you settle things between you and the council. And he tells him that the council only knows about our roles as much as it needs to.
Mm-hmm.
So he's, this is why I feel like he's kind of saying, the council doesn't need to know about you being the Winter Knight.
Oh, I see.
And that
that's
maybe,
interesting. I didn't take it that way.
Like, I don't know if this is what he was saying, but that's how I read it, because clearly he's telling Harry that the council doesn't know what fucking gates I keep for real.
For sure, yeah.
And I've been able to keep that from them, so I have the ability or the resources or something to help you do the same. Mm-hmm. I read a lot into that, I'll admit. But and he tells him that he's going to, like, help verify the council that Harry is who he is, you know, that he's not dead. And I'll get some back pay, too, which, mm-hmm. again, let's not pretend like that's not important.
Yeah, Harry. Come on, buddy. You're staying with Molly right now. You can't sustain that. Where are you going to live? Maybe Mab provides something.
I mean, my assumption was that he could spend as much time in winter as he needed. He doesn't have to be out in the mortal world if he doesn't want to.
But, like, would you want to if you were him?
I mean, if he starts to give in to the mantle of the Winter Knight, then yeah, why not?
Well, I'm saying, like, let's say he saves the world in the next 2 days. And then he has to figure out where he's going to stay.
What do you think? Again, I think, it doesn't make sense that my assumption was that he could just, you know, have a nice, cushy life in winter, because he clearly doesn't want that for himself.
I mean, I wouldn't want to fucking sleep there. God knows what turns up.
Yeah, that's true. That's a good point.
It doesn't seem like Mab has interest in protecting him in any real way. She's like, protect yourself or don't. That's right. On you.
Yeah, so she's definitely not setting him up with an apartment. You're right. She's not thinking about shit like that. She doesn't care about shit like that. And then Rashid flies away on a magic carpet, you guys.
Oh, my God. I had such mixed feelings
about this. I don't know what to do with that.
Same.
Because, like, we know that Rashid is, Middle Eastern in some way. I don't know if we know exactly where he's from, right?
Mm-hmm.
But there's a...
Yeah, Harry doesn't really know. He says that his, accent's flavored and he's sort of swarthy and that's about it.
And at the beginning, I think when he first takes his hood off, Harry mentions that he's paler, but mm-hmm. still definitely, non-white.
Mm-hmm.
So, also, though, I feel like I don't know Rashid really well, and yet I feel very comfortable in being, him choosing to ride the magic carpet is maybe him just being like, yeah, fuck it, why not?
That's a good point. I appreciate that idea of just him being like, I'm riding off magic carpet. Shut up.
And to be fair, I don't know if this is something the butcher would look into. I don't know anything about it. If I am speaking out of turn, my apologies. But there's also, it's possible that there is some significance to the idea of a magic carpet in that culture that I am missing, you know? Mm. So this may not actually be like a kind of a fuck you funny thing. It may be based in something that's culturally relevant that I am just wildly uninformed about.
Gotcha. So. That's true. That's fair. Interesting.
Yeah, I don't know if Butcher would, I don't know if that's something he would look into and incorporate, or if he just thinks... I feel like Butcher just thinks it's funny.
I think so. But, again, yeah, I have nothing to base that on, so...
Yeah.
The whole thing with this conversation that I like is just this side character who you find very mysterious, but you don't really get what the deal is, turning out to be very significant, and you gotta not do that.
I'm so sorry. Sorry.
But I always like when there's a payoff to somebody that you've been sort of like, what is their deal anyway? And then it turns out, oh, they have a really massive deal, actually. Something that is so important that I thought he was some sort of secret agent for the White Council. But it's so important that the White Council isn't even aware of this whole thing, evidently. Or else maybe some of them are. It's unclear if anybody knows or if nobody knows.
Yeah. Things with the White Council are so unclear in general, though.
True.
That I really, you know, didn't spend much time considering who may or may not know, because there seem to be, especially now, last that we checked in with them, you know, there are different factions. We have this whole idea of, like, the Black Council working within the White Council.
Mm-hmm.
You know, then there's, like, personal relationships. So that Rashid seems to have been aware that Margaret was Ebenezer's daughter.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not common knowledge. So it gets, like, really tricky.
Yeah. So he tells Mother Summer to bring him home, and she interprets that as, I'm putting you exactly back where you were.
Yeah, you gotta be in really clear. You gotta be very, very specific.
He did not think that through entirely.
Yeah, yeah. So there's a bit of a scene when he is leaving his grave, because there's a bunch of goth kids hanging out, and I just thought that was a funny little aside.
I found this hilarious. Dude, that's pretty hardcore down there.
Mm-hmm.
They chatted amongst themselves and came to the agreement that I was indeed pretty hardcore down there. Oh, that got me laughing so much. And later on, Molly is like, why do you smell like cloves?
Oh, my God. And she's like, soon as he says, kids today, she's like, ah, the goths. I guess that's grave dirt. Like, makes the connection immediately. God, I can't believe what time it is. Shit. We talk way too much at the beginning of these things.
We always do. We always do.
Guys, we need an intervention. We do. It's out of hand.
And we always are like, this time we really got to get going right away. We really do. Oh, yeah, we definitely do. I also have someplace to be. And then, well, just real quick before we get started, just really quick, I just needed to tell you about this thing that happened. You will not believe this shit.
Every time. Every single time. So, this thing, when he comes home, right, the first thing he does is take a shower. And it's like, of course, because he's been, like, you know, through a lot. And he was in that grave, and it was muddy, and it was gross. And all of that's important, but the most important thing is this idea that he has been up close and personal, he says, with very powerful creatures.
Mm-hmm.
And that he basically got a little red on him, you know? He just, he's, you know, some schmutz, some, like, magical schmutz. And he wants to wash it away, because having that on you can influence you and also impact how your magic works.
Yeah, that was really interesting.
Yeah, I thought so too. He says that it happens with humans, with people, with just our auras.
Yeah.
But because they're not as powerful, the effect is negligible, but it does happen. And I think that is, you know, it's like when you are around someone that has, you know, oh, really bad energy, you know, and you kind of, like, feel it. And then when you are not in their presence, sometimes it's last anyway.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah. When he describes it as being kind of clinging, I was like, yeah, that sounds right.
Psychic vampires.
That too.
I think about that with my grandmother all the time. I loved her dearly, but God, yeah. He definitely kind of wanted to, like, get her influence off you. So, yeah, he gets interrupted as he's dressing by Lacuna, who wants to know what the deal is with clothes anyway. Why do you even do this? It's weird. They don't save you from arrows or anything, even though your shirt does say something about arrows, which is extra confusing.
Well, I laughed so hard at this ridiculous ass joke. It is not even that funny, but when she is like, because she asks, did you get it from, like, your weapons dealer, basically? And he's like, no. She's like, well, you're wearing someone else's weapon dealer shirt. Like, like, make it make sense.
Yep. I think that for me, it was the audiobook, because he does this voice for Lacuna, and it's Why are you wearing the shirt of someone else's weapons dealer? And he's like, you shouldn't startle wizards. Why? Because of what could happen. Because they might fall down on the floor? And I just fucking died at that delivery. It just... Because they might fall down on the floor is such a burn. And she doesn't even mean it that way.
Well, yeah, because she's like a... First, because he's like, you know, don't scare me. And she's like, you're like six times my size, dude. Where are you scared? Mm-hmm. And I've agreed to be your captive. Like, what are you talking about? He gets all offended. I'm not afraid. I was just startled. my goodness gracious.
It turns out that he has a visitor. And yeah. She just, like, didn't... She talked about her own shit for 10 minutes before informing him of this.
When
Why
he
didn't
says,
you tell me? I did, just now. Do you have guys, brain damage?
You guys.
Oh, God.
Why is she so saucy, though? Oh, I love her. I love her.
So, he goes out there, and it's Sarissa looking not great.
Yeah, yeah.
He says... She had a red mouse on her face.
What does that mean?
I never heard this term in my life. I am assuming it means like
a bruise, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I never heard that expression either. I was going to ask you about it.
Okay.
Like it's definitely like it's like a welt or something because it's swelling up. He says it's starting to turn purple. I don't know, but maybe that's some.
I thought maybe it was something real old-fashioned, and as an old head, you could tell me what it was.
Damn. That was uncalled for. So, the red cap has done this to her, and sent her with a message, and the red cap has gone and snatched up everyone that we hold near and dear.
Mm-hmm.
They have been following Harry, so they have Butters,
mm-hmm.
They have Andy,
mm-hmm.
They have Mac, which I was really surprised by that inclusion.
Yeah,
right?
That one's weird.
Because I feel like...
He's part of the Accord in Neutral Territory, goddammit.
First of all, right? And then, like, this involving him in this type of action, coupled with what happened at his bar, I feel like, is Mac about to be a player? Because you gave, like, we got a little hint that there's a lot more to Mac than meets the eye, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he told Harry that he's, like, not getting into this.
Yeah.
And now he has been brought into this. And I'm just really curious if that means, you know, what that means for us.
Right.
And they have Justine.
Yeah, another weird one.
Yeah, so, and you know, he'll release them if Harry surrenders by sundown. Which, who has time for this nonsense? We have a whole other thing that's getting ready to happen tonight.
He is so tiresome.
Oh, really, dude? Like, I'm really annoyed, because this red cap jet is to my mind small potatoes.
Mm-hmm.
And all I can think is that you, sir, think that you're the big villain of this story, of this book.
Mm.
And you're not.
What if he is, though?
I will be disgusted. Surprise! I will be disgusted. Oh, my God. So,
I'm sorry. I put that in your head, and now you hate it. That's funny, though.
It's not, though. So they're going to use the hairs to do a tracking spell, which I'm like, you sent a wizard the hair of each person he would probably want to find.
Mm.
So either you're not very smart, which is definitely a possibility, Or it's worse, and this is a trap, because Harry is, of course, going to use the hairs to track them. So I don't know where we are yet on that, right? Like, it's possible that he just is not smart. I mean, I would assume a lot of things. I would assume that being Fae, Harry is not the first wizard he's ever met and dealt with. So it seems weird to me that he wouldn't consider this as a possibility. Mm-hmm. So that makes me think, oh, well, this is a trap then. He wants to maybe purposefully distract Harry for some weird-ass reason or get him to show up at a place for some other kind of ambush. Mm. So I'm really torn. I'm not exactly sure what to think of that yet. But regardless, Harry is using these hairs to track them, because what else is he going to do?
That is kind of what it comes down to.
Yeah.
So yeah, they're doing the tracking spell. Molly is. And he asks how she's progressing on this. And she says, he calls for Cat Sith. Mm-hmm. And nothing happens. And this makes him very uncomfortable. Because Cat Sith has always turned up the moment he was asked for.
Yeah.
And Harry even does an insulting here, kitty, kitty, kitty thing.
Really? Really? When he gets to the third call and he doesn't show up, even I was like, but the third call, though?
Mm-hmm.
And then even Harry mentions, like, we all know the third call means business. And it's, you know, Katsu still hasn't shown up. This is a problem. And it makes Harry start to wonder if this is evidence of Mab just setting him up.
Mm.
You know, getting him used to having Katsu available to him to help him when he needs it, only to pull that resource away
right
when he needs it the most. So, you know, he starts to kind of spin out about what that could mean, mm-hmm. you know, and what if Cat Sith had actually been infected and hit and has turned, which is not even worse than Mab, but pretty fucking bad for Harry, especially.
Yeah, definitely. So he goes back inside. He tells Lacuna that she's on house duty. If any of the little folk come back with a location where the rite is taking place, I want you to write down their descriptions and mark the location on the map. Can you do that? I think so. Probably. Maybe. And then he asks, Molly, how are those spells coming along? I think there's some kind of counterspell hiding them. It's tricky, so stop bumping my elbow. I'm concentrating over here. And he has this fucking moment.
Yeah. And we've had these moments ugly. Before, mm-hmm. but it's ugly. I'm not sure if it feels like it's a ramp up or not, as far as like what his urge to do is, because the last couple of times the urge has been pretty foul as well.
Mm-hmm.
So this feels just sort of like a continuation.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it starts off first with not just anger, but, like, being insulted at how dare Molly speak to him in such a way, mm-hmm. you know? Another wizard would have been beaten unconscious to, you know, after speaking like that. And then it goes into something else.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the anger twists into this urge to, he says, put her in her place.
Yep.
Take out his frustrations on her. Show her which of us is the strongest. And that he had a really primitive idea of how to make that happen.
And he looks up and Sarissa is gone.
Yeah, she fucking felt... We're talking about energy.
Mm-hmm.
Like, she's, like, understood. She's been around predators enough. He says that she has good instincts when it came to predators. So she bounced, goes and locks herself in a room. And then Molly is still standing there,
mm-hmm.
but she has basically understood what was happening the entire time. Mm-hmm. And not just understood it in some sort of nebulous way, like She might as well have been reading his mind.
Mm-hmm.
So she knew the specifics of what these urges were telling him. And she stays. And she just asks if he's okay. He kind of blows it off. And they figure out that they need to use steel in the spell for the tracking.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they have this thing where, like, they don't really go into what just happened in his head. You know, he goes and makes a sandwich. Mm-hmm. She's working on the spell. They figure out where they need to go. They're going to say goodbye to Sarissa. And they don't have a talk about it until they're in the car, which is a couple paragraphs later.
Yeah, because first they have to go pick up the car from the Svarthaus, and it's been mm-hmm. repaired, and they want mm-hmm. to confirm with them that it's definitely not booby-trapped, or, you know, there's no bomb in it, or God
right,
knows
right,
what.
Right, No enchantments, no trackers, no, like, listening spells.
Mm-hmm.
They're assuring her that this is the same security process that Mr. Atree uses, so it's, like, top of the line. Mm-hmm. Like, don't worry about it.
We're passing the car beneath a waterfall to rub off any lasting enchantments, which I just love that detail, that they just have, like, a waterfall around for this, like,
oh my
in the
God.
Garage somewhere.
I didn't even think of that. That's amazing. I like my brain just pictured like a car wash, like nothing fancy.
I mean, it might be for all we know.
No, this is so much better. And of course it's a waterfall. What are you talking about? Of course it is. They're not fucking around with no like speedy shine car wash with this kind of shit that they need to take care of.
Oh, that's funny.
And we find out that the mechanic is Harry's old mechanic.
The fucking note that Cat Sith left for him. Oh, where is the fucking... I want the actual... Where is it? Here it is.
Found it.
He was waiting at the shop. Prepare this for Harry Dresden and return it to the following address or suffer, mortal Smith.
Like, Mike's face reading this note. Like, what's...
I have no idea what he could be thinking.
All I can picture is, like, what Putty would say if he read that note.
Putty! Oh, that's just, pretty good.
He would just be like, nah, okay, whatever.
Okay. Babe.
High five.
I like to think that maybe because Mike has gotten to know Harry so well, that he just thinks that this is Harry's, like, it's just a joke. He's just being a weirdo. So, yeah. The car pulls up. It looks bonkers, as usual.
Mm-hmm.
And they get in the car, and they talk about the terms of the alliance that she has. And it turns out the apartment is hers outright. She actually owns it. It's not mm-hmm. on loan, which is pretty right. cool.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They handle any maintenance for the next 50 years. And as long as I'm on their property, they consider me to be a citizen of their nation with all the rights and privileges that entails. And Harry's like, wow.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Yeah.
It's pretty fucking good. And he asks her about how much she trusts them, specifically Mr. Atree.
Mm-hmm.
And she has a really, I think, clear idea of who and what he is.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, you know, basically, he might be against you, he might fuck you up, he might cut your throat, but he's not going to lie about his intentions. He's always going to be, you know, clear.
He's going to be like, I'm about to cut your throat now.
Yeah.
Just FYI, that's coming.
And she tells to Harry, like, you know what, and I like this because it sounds, because he says, tell me about your friend. And she says, he's not a friend, he's an ally, and he's good at it. And I like that, because it's not, I'm not sure if Harry meant to be sort of condescending.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Like, oh, Molly can't tell the difference between like a friend and an accomplice or an ally or whatever, right?
Right.
And she has to be like, no, I see exactly what this is. Thank you very much.
Yep.
You know?
Yep. Agreed. So, yeah, it's a pretty sweet setup that she's got going on. I'm just like, man, Molly really has done better with the jobs that she has pulled off in terms of getting a payback than Harry has with the shit that he has done.
He says, you know, kind of like acknowledging how well she's done. And he says, look at you all grown up. And then she says, you have been all day. Mm. And then we get into it. This was uncomfortable reading. And this is going to be sort of contrary to practically everything I've ever said. I am not really mad about it, though.
Okay.
There's a... She is... I don't know. I don't... What she says is... you know, first that she acknowledges that she understands and she feels like what's going on inside of him. And then she says, if it's given, freely offered, you can't take it away. Because he tells her, don't worry, I'm not going to let it make me take anything away from you. They're really like dancing around.
Yes, definitely.
A thing. They were when Harry was having the urge, too. He danced around. Like he says, you know, there was something he could do, but he doesn't name it. But we all know, like, what the fuck he's talking about. But her reply about how all you're doing is accepting a gift was uncomfortable for me because it has Molly not being able or choosing not to distinguish between the mantle, which is making him have these intense feelings and having difficulty managing them, versus what Harry Dresden would, like, want to do.
Right.
Now, granted, there is an argument to be made that really the mantle is not just corrupting, but it's also amplifying.
Right.
You know, and it's taking some of your less virtuous impulses and really putting them on blast.
Correct.
So someone could be like, well, no, that's Harry's desire as well. And I just... what she says to him in response is just... I am uncomfortable because I think it is striking a nerve in me that that is something that young people can do. That is something that young women can often fall into.
What is that?
The...
Because when you say they often... It's like people don't have winter mantles.
No.
So what do you mean?
I mean... Like, and Harry touches on it later when he's thinking... I don't know if he says this out loud or if he's thinking to himself. When he's talking about the master-apprentice relationship. So what I think of is I think of young women and professors.
Right.
Or doctors, therapists, boss, you know, bosses. Men who are in where there's a real power differential. And the young woman might really have feelings, you know, real feelings, real sexual desire, and be willing to offer it up. Like she's saying, right? And what happens in those moments for me is, not always, but often, I will look at the older person and be like, yeah, they're offering, but you know better. You know, and that's what I'm talking about. Like my discomfort around this is because it feels, even though it's very supernatural and all this kind of stuff, it, that sort of... you don't have to feel bad about what you're doing because I am offering it to you. I'm telling you it's okay. You know, that's the kind of thing I'm talking about.
Right.
And then this just goes on for quite some time where he's just talking about how exceptionally beautiful she is and that he's seen her naked.
The usual, you know. But yeah, and he also like acknowledges the, like you said, the fact that he would be taking advantage of what seems like just well, I'm willing to have sex with you. But really, he knows that she has been carrying a torch for him for ages. And he is going to be in full awareness of that while, like, being willing to break her heart.
Yeah.
In the end. Yeah. Because he knows that he doesn't feel that way about her. And that's really what she's, in her heart of hearts, wanting is that connection.
Exactly. Exactly. And that she would be just devastated. And he ends up saying to her, you know, because she says one more time, like she whispers, you know, that it's okay. It's really okay. And he just tells her, I don't think it's ever going to happen. But if it does, the first time isn't going to be like that. You deserve better, and so do I.
I like and that.
Yeah.
I appreciated that.
Yeah. It was a tough moment to read through this. It was very uncomfortable. But like I said at the beginning, I didn't hate it because I kind of think it was necessary to address it. Especially as these impulses keep coming up. And we all know that when she's near him, she's fully aware. So if we hadn't talked about it, if we had just pretended like, you know, that didn't happen, I would feel a way about it.
Yeah, most definitely. I agree with that.
And then they get to where they're going, y'all.
Oh, my God. I love the fact that I was talking about all this shit in the plot in my intro. And as soon as I'm done and I'm like, all right, so what did you think? You're like, Mouse? Hello, Dodo Bird. Like, I can't believe that you didn't even bring him up. Honestly, I can't believe I didn't either. What a good boy he is.
Oh, he's such a good boy. Yeah. He's so happy. At first, right, when they show up at the house, I'm just like, what is happening? Because nobody is home. You know? And I'm like, what are they there for? Who's home? And for some reason, my brain went to David. I was like, oh, well, maybe they need David for some reason.
Oh, her brother. Yeah.
You know, like, he's tangentially a part of the story. We know he knows about what's going on in the world. And, you know, he's kind of badass in his own way. So I was like, maybe this is like a backup situation because the people he would normally go for backup are the ones he's going to rescue. So they get to the house and she's running down, like, you know, where everybody is and no one's home. And she mentions that, you know, dad is working. Mom has the little ones. And I'm like, well, that leaves David. And then there's this bumping on the door and the way she backs away, Molly backs away from the door. And I misread that. And I was like, oh, no, something's in the house. You know?
I love this.
So I honestly didn't know.
Molly, you in danger, girl.
That's what I felt like. And the door finally opens. And the way it's described, the door is being opened by someone with their hands full. And I'm just like, oh, this is something they probably barely even need. Like, I don't know what the fuck is on the other side of the door. And you guys, it's Mouse. And I could not have been more delighted. I honestly could not have been happier. And the rest is just, he's so happy to see him. And Molly apparently can now, like, talk to him.
Yes, or, she can understand him. Yeah.
And, it's so good. It's so good. It's just, I mean, like, I just really not like that, you know, he jumps on and there's tail wagging, there's lots of licks, there's barks, you know. There's a reminder to the reader of who Mouse is, like, that's even fucking necessary. But whatever. And he just tackles him, and it's just great.
Yeah, I really want to see Mister now. Where's Mister?
Yeah,
at?
Yeah.
What's going on? But yeah, this whole bit, it's just really fun to see, because Mouse had encountered Harry while he was a ghost. And, I don't know if what kind of, like, dog senses Mouse had, like, because obviously he's got some supernatural ability. And it's unclear to me what exactly it is.
Right.
Because can he tell that Harry's back from the dead before he sees Harry? Or is this like a shock that he didn't know Harry was alive again?
From the way that Mouse is trying to get out of the house in what I can only imagine is like overwhelming excitement, you know, mm-hmm. that he's fumbling at the door and like throwing his body up against it. He knows that it's Harry, like immediately outside. And I think that he has known Harry has been back.
Do you think so? Okay.
I do. I don't know why. I just do. And I feel like I don't know. I don't have anything to base that on. But something in my heart just tells me that he was aware when Harry made it back through into our realm. Whatever, however you want to like define that.
Okay. Well, I accept this.
There was a fun little bit in the when isn't there a moment with Mr. Two when we find out that Mr. is like clearly aware that Harry is in the room?
Oh yeah, Mr. right? is like the thing that convinces everybody because Mortimer right. has been there for like hours trying to convince them, and then Mr. just runs in and like butts up against Harry's legs, and Mort's really irritated that like nobody believed him, but then this one cat shows up and everybody's suddenly like, oh my god, he's here. Mort's like, wow, cool guys, thanks.
And then so the ends with Harry, you tell him Mouse, you know, he needs help. And he tells him, you know, the bad guys took Butters, Andy, and Justine. And Molly says that Mouse says Andy should be locked in a garage at night until she learns not to get abducted.
Sir! She's your elder.
Harry says, once we get her back, we'll start calling her danger-prone Daphne. it's good stuff. It's really good stuff. And yeah, that's how it ends. Molly translates that, of course, Mouse is in, and Harry's like, yeah, good thing you're here. That's really tough to read.
I enjoy that.
Yeah, good stuff.
So what do you think is going to happen with the rescue? How do you think that's going to go down?
You know what? I'm really not sure because, like I said earlier, I have this nagging feeling like this may be a trap. Mm-hmm. But there's so much else going on. Like he needs to deal with this jailbreak situation. And I don't know yet if, like I mentioned, like if this is I don't know. Like, if this is a distraction. I mean, I know that the importance of what's maybe happening this evening with the bomb feels like everybody knows, and yet no, we're not sure who all knows, you know? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know if Red Cap understands what else is going on right now. Mm. And I don't have any justification for why the Red Cap would want everything to go kablooey, but it doesn't mean he doesn't. Not wanting. Remember that episode of Buffy where Spike is like joins in? I think it's season two.
Oh my after God,
after Angel turns, mm-hmm. and he agrees to help stop it, and they're just all like, "But you're a bad guy. Why?" And he's like, "Well, you know, I've grown accustomed to like being living on Earth. I'm not exactly alive, but you know,
yeah."
He, I think he says something like, "The Earth is where all the people are, and I like to eat them," or something like that. So, yeah, so I don't know. I don't know.
Sorry, there's a line in the Cradle books where she's talking about, like, the, as long as the way remains undisturbed, human beings could enjoy luxuries like causality and existence. And that's kind of what I'm thinking of with this. Like, yes, you might be a bad guy, but don't you enjoy causality and existence? Those luxuries, sir?
Yeah.
Existence
is key.
Exactly. So real quick, first new patron of the month is Sophia Ricci. Welcome, Sophia. Thank you so much for becoming a patron. You guys can join us at patreon.com/unspoiled if you would like to get access to some other stuff. I also want to let you all know that I have updated the website to be a little bit more helpful regarding questions about commissioning Spoil Me's, getting access to the crowdcast for Spoil Me's and all that. And I think that's about it. So, yeah, I really appreciate y'all. I hope that you have been enjoying the coverage. Thank you all again. And come visit us at the site and, you know, become a patron and join us in the Facebook groups. And if you're not a patron, you can still join the Dresden Files Facebook group. There's a Dresden Files spoilers group. So if you want to go there, it's not super active right now because it's still a pretty small group. But, you know, I want it to be more active. So get in there and get chatting, everybody. And I think that's everything. Anything you want to add, ma'am?
No, ma'am.
All right. Well, thank you all again so much for listening. We appreciate you, and we will see you next week with 3 more chapters. Until then, toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Was an Unspoiled Network podcast.